overdrive you can shift into without losing time on the racetrack.
The eagle's ready to land on top of the rabbit and take him away, and NASCAR is hoping it would.
Seems like you get to chasing your tail. You get to making this circle.
Oh, right between his legs!
NASCAR wouldn't allow that to happen today.
If the rabbit would just go around to turn three, there's a hole in the wall. He could get out.
That's right.
I want to believe that we're going to be competitive in any kind of situation.
He is a silly rabbit.
Kernan coming up on RPM tonight. Ricky Rudd says it's possible five owners could eventually have it all in Winston Cup racing. Course improvements top the news from Belle Isle, and Tony Stewart smokes them at Texas. But first, the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series hit the track Thursday at the Texas Motor Speedway, breaking into some new territory. Not only is it the truck's first visit to the Lone Star State, it's also the first time they've gone as fast as they did. Defending series champ Ron Hornaday ran a lap at 171.211 miles an hour. Only 21st fastest on the day, points leader Rich Bickle. Fourth fastest lap during practice, 174.5. A little bit faster than Mike Bliss, who checked in at 174.8 miles an hour. But the fastest lap of the day belonged to Jack Spring, 176.783 miles an hour. Kenny Irwin Jr. was the only other driver to top 176. Look back in the fifth spot. That's Trans Am star Ron Fellows, 174.233. Former ARCA champ Bob Keselowski was sixth fastest on a day when the trucks went faster than ever before.
That lap was averaging 177 or 178 mile an hour. You're running pretty good. You're only dropping like 5 mile an hour in turn three and four, and probably 12 and one and two. So you're hauling the mail.
We got to test here a month or so ago, and we tested good then, and we're right there up in the top. So you know, I think we can qualify up there.
These things push bad enough to keep putting spoiler on us, and spoiler and spoiler on us. I mean, if they had to drive these things this one time to know how bad they push, and then try to get the front end to stay down at a place like this, they wouldn't give us a spoiler all the time. But that's the way they do it. That's what they're, you know, they're ball in their game. We got to play by the rules, and at least they let us widen the fenders a little bit. That helped us a little bit, but the more degree of spoiler, I think, hurt more than add widen the fenders. So the front end didn't seem like it helped that much, but we're plenty tight.
Earlier this week, we told you there were 70-some trucks entered to Texas. Only 33 were out on the track Thursday. They raced Friday night under the lights on ESPN. The Indy Racing League held a unique round of qualifying Wednesday night at Texas. The drivers ran a couple of laps at speed, then came around and made a two-tire pit stop. It was then averaged, and the guy with the fastest average speed won the pole. We pick up the action with Buddy Lazier on pit road after completing two laps at speed. He smokes the tires, winds up fourth, average 165.318 miles an hour. Some drivers had trouble with the pit stop concept. Billy Boat cannot get stopped in time. He registered no speed at all. Then Aliceo Salazar forgets about the second lap, comes down to the pits after only one lap at speed. And speaking of speed, Tony Stewart did two laps at more than 216 miles an hour, throwing the pit stop for an average of 167.133, and that wins the pole. Kenny Breck earned the highest qualifying
laps. I knew we ran two really fast laps, and you know, the stop was good. I knew we had a good stop too, so it didn't surprise me when they told me. We just didn't know for sure.
The laps were good. I mean, you know, I got out to speed, and I was flat out from the first lap, and I had a little wiggle coming off four, but it was okay, you know. I kept it in there, and the hardest part in this thing is to get into the pits quick enough, and then obviously I have the Monsoon Gallus team that takes care of the pit stop, so that was good, you know. It's a good deal.
On the racetrack, I was just flat out, never lifted, you know, and you want to build your momentum here for qualifying, so it was just as fast as I could go on the racetrack, and unfortunately, because a lot of us, none of us, I don't think, have gone into that pit lane, so you don't know how much you can take going down pit, you know, pit road. But and you always feel like you left some on the racetrack, so I feel like I could have gone and gotten a little more.
Kenny Breck earned the highest qualifying spot of the 12 rookies in the field. Breck averaged 165.480 miles an hour. Overall, the qualifying format received mixed reviews.
No, I don't like this format. The guys got a great job. I think it's great for the fans, but you know, it's you come in and go through your drive-through, pick up your lunch, and then take off. I guess. I mean, I love the format of going and trying to find the last tenth or two on the racetrack.
This is very much a team sport. It's a very difficult thing to get right, and mechanics have a lot to say with how things go. And look out there in the public. The public love it. They're seeing everything now.
It was fun. It's different. I don't know. It's definitely not the fastest car on the track. You know, Tony would still be probably on the pole for that, but it's fun. It's different.
I don't lay awake at night thinking about IndyCar racing anymore, but I definitely laid awake last night thinking about how this was going to work and how we're going to come off the track that fast on the warm-up lane. And, you know, everything went pretty good, actually. Just, you know, more my mistake than anything in the pits, and that should have been the easy part.
Eddie Tiber heads up the next group of qualifiers just ahead of Jim Guthrie. Davey Hamilton starts ninth, followed by Buzz Calkins, Ari Lyndike, and Marco Greco. The IRL race can be seen Saturday night on ESPN2. The PPG Car World Series unloaded Thursday at the Belle Isle Road Course in the Detroit area. Practice doesn't start until Friday, but Marlo Klein had no trouble finding drivers to talk about the improvements organizers have made to that controversial course.
Widespread driver dissent forced the Detroit Grand Prix organizers to make changes to the raceway on Belle Isle. Bumps that the drivers complained about are smoother, and turns 1, 7, and 13 have been altered.
Last year, there was a lot of complaints about the bumps, and I think that was, at least my point of view, the major complaint. And they tried to smooth out the track. I mean, we'll go out there tomorrow and find out how good a job it was done.
Last year, the cement in all the turns was extremely rough. I mean, very brutally rough. And they've come in, and I've just come from there, going around, and they've ground off a lot of the cement, made it a lot smoother. I think it's going to be just a lot nicer circuit to drive on. There's grooves in the track, almost like a pair of corduroy pants. So that's really hard on tires. And knowing what Goodyear has brought here, hopefully, you know, we're not going to have any problems. But it's a pretty soft tire, so I don't, you know, it's questionable whether it'll live.
By the time the teams return to Belle Isle next year, this track will have gone through a major overhaul. This is the current layout of the course. But August 1st, construction will begin on a new configuration. They will eliminate some turns and add this straightaway. Scott Pruitt grabbed the pole here last year under sunny skies. Race day was another story, as were the Firestone rain tires.
It was actually last year coming away from this race because the Tuesday after this race, we went to the Ford test track. They were kind enough to let us use it. I don't know if you've been over to it, but they can wet the track down so we can do some rain tire testing, and they were right on it.
I personally did a lot of tire tests with Firestone on the rain configuration, and I believe we made huge progress. Now, we didn't have a good year set to try to evaluate how much we improved, but I want to believe that we're going to be competitive in any kind of situation.
Christian Fittipaldi underwent surgery today in Indianapolis to take out the screws in his leg. Fittipaldi is expected to make his return to the car Tuesday at a Mid-Ohio test. If things go as planned, Detroit will be his substitute Roberto Moreno's last race in the number 11 Budweiser car.
It's very difficult to continue the season mid-season, find another team or in car to drive. So I might be doing some IMSA races until the end of the year and some GTs towards the end of the season.
Kart qualifying comes your way Saturday on the deuce at 44 thousandths of a second over Ed Barrier for Saturday's ARCA race. Great qualifying run for Frank Kimmel. He starts third for Steele. The qualifying run produced a new track record for the ARCA cars, and he's with Bill Weber.
Well, off the frustrating 2 weeks at Charlotte, Tim Steele capturing his familiar form in fine fashion. You're putting your Ford on the pole with a new ARCA track record. I know that. It's a big boost for you.
Yeah, it is, you know, and we really didn't have everything we needed for qualifying. You know, I'm really looking forward to the race. Maybe we can take some of this bad luck we've been having and turn it around. You know, after a year like last year when we couldn't do no wrong basically anywhere, you person kind of gets spoiled, you know, and then you got to pick your heads up and keep going. And you know, that's what we've done. We came here ready. We went to Michigan and tested about a week and a half ago and figured out some things there, and we know was able to bring it here, and it helped us.
Fifth in points, 350 behind the leader. You're running for the championship. Can you get there?
Are we that many behind them?
Yes, sir.
we'll just go to every race and do the best we can do, and when the points come, they come, and you know, we'll not worry about it. Last year we don't, you know, worry about points racing at all, and we just have to lead as many laps as we can and set on as many poles and win as many races. I guess that'll be the big secret.
Okay, and he is worrying about winning, but he's a strong car here, and when he wins, the points usually come. Back to the studio.
Thanks, Bill. Bobby Gerhardt in Lebanon, Pennsylvania, heads up the next list of qualifiers for the Mountain Dew 400K. And look there in the ninth position, Dave Blaney won a World of Outlaws race Wednesday night. Thursday afternoon, he qualified ninth.
I'm still scared. I've never seen this place before and run about five practice laps. And, I just wasn't ready, you know. But, I don't know, just made a lap. Wherever it ends up, we'll get in the race. I get some practice with some good guys, and I'll start to learn some.
It was okay. We just had a real bad push up in out of three or four or whatever that one is up there. But that's the best lap we've run. That's the second quicker than practice. But I'll take that. We go a little better. I left 3/10 out there and down in 3, so we'll get better tomorrow. I'm going to change 4 springs tonight.
We didn't make a run on sticker tires, and I wish we would have because the car was way too tight and left a lot laying out there, I believe. So hopefully, you know, we'll put the, you know, some older tires on and get ready for the race. And hopefully we can run with that 16 car this time.
We picked the starting grid back up with the 13th position. That's held by Tim Bainey at 151.776 miles an hour. And Gary Clark starts 17th at 149.646. Only 21 drivers ran qualifying laps on Thursday. 12 other drivers were at the track but didn't make it out for time trials. Coming up on RPM tonight, we explore the key to running well at Pocono. And we talk with Ricky Rudd as he looks ahead to the future of NASCAR Winston Cup racing.
I just hate to see people like Bud Moore that built this sport, a real solid foundation, be squeezed out of racing right now. It wouldn't be impossible to see 5 car owners own the entire sport.
Extended his streak of winning at least one race each year to 15 seasons. Rudd is one of a handful of owner drivers on the NASCAR Winston Cup circuit. We sat down with him earlier this week to talk about his team and the future of the sport.
Are you surprised, or did you ever imagine that this sport would be to the level that it is right now?
Whether it had ever grown or not, we'd have still been a part of the sport. It's just kind of exciting to watch it grow up around us. We didn't, you know, we never came into the sport saying, I want to go run Winston Cup racing because it's the biggest there is, and, you know, we'll get all this exposure and we'll make these big purses, you know. That wasn't even a consideration. We started off, and I think I was making $90 a week, and I was driving the car, working at my dad's salvage yard, junkyard at the time, and no one ever thought that you could actually come here and make a good, healthy living. We never thought about that. We were just a bunch of guys that loved racing and was going to make our career out of it. I came in from motorcycles, go-kart background, right into my first race period was a Winston Cup event. First time I was in a stock car. NASCAR wouldn't allow that to happen today, so you have to have more or less a resume before you can ever be accepted on a Winston Cup entry nowadays. But when I came in, I would qualify maybe 24th or 25th or whatever that might be in my first year. I might be 2 seconds off the pole speed. And at least I got in the race. I was able to get track knowledge and learn. Guys today have to be prepared better than that when they get here. They got to be ready to contend.
There's no way that we can race with less spoiler than what those guys have. It's kind of like whoever cries the loudest, you know, gets the things swung their way for a little while.
The Ford car is substantially disadvantaged.
I don't make the rules. All I do is drive.
All of this really was a result of Chevrolet switching to from the Lumina to the Monte Carlo, and they did their homework. They came up with a very good race car, so good that I think it was maybe misrepresented a little bit with NASCAR that it really wasn't that good of a car. And from the time it came out, all the cuts and allowances were made to the Ford, which is very expensive. You know, if the car was misrepresented, then make those guys spend some money. I just want to have a car that is equal to the Pontiac, equal to the Chevrolet, and let the races be decided on who the best drivers are on that given day, who the best pit crew, who the best team is on a given day, and not be worried about, you know, one manufacturer having the advantage over the other. It gets frustrating for the fact that it seems like you get to chasing your tail, you get to making this circle. You get a spoiler cut or something happens this week and you say, well, okay, we'll live with this, we'll deal with it. About the time you take 15 race cars and cut the bodies off of them to rebalance them aerodynamically, which is very expensive, then all of a sudden, about the time you get the bodies going back on these cars, it changes again. Never fails. You about get everything caught back up, get everything painted, and then the rule changes again.
What is the future of Rudd Performance Motorsports? 2 cars, maybe?
If you go back 2 or 3 years ago, our team is equally as funded as any other organization out there. Until I call the super teams come along, you've got, I guess, Hendrick's organization leads the way with that. Then you got Robert Yates, and you got Jack Roush, and now you got Childress. Really, the way the rules are set up, the testing and so on, those guys should win every race. If I was Hendrick's and my 3 cars didn't win every race out there, I'd be questioning why not. You know, what's wrong? They've got 180 employees. We have about 20, 25 people here. My opinion is, the sport doesn't need to be set up where a wealthy car owner can buy wins, and I'm afraid it's headed that way. I just hate to see people like Bud Moore that built this sport, a real solid foundation, be squeezed out of racing right now, and it's just the beginning of it. It's going to happen, and it wouldn't be impossible to see 5 car owners own the entire sport. I just don't think it's healthy for the future. Our goals are simple. We're not in this to generate millions of dollars to put in our pocket. Everything that we win on the racetrack goes back into the team. You know, if we I guess I don't have to be as accurate with the business decisions because I own it and I drive it. And if we misjudge or we have to spend more money in research and development, I can go over there and take a big chunk of the driver's salary away and take that money and put it back in R&D, where hardly any other race team has that option. We're building for the future, so we're able to rob a little bit of the driver's salary occasionally when we need it. And you know, he doesn't complain too much. I'm just as happy now as I was when we first started racing and just kind of lived out of a suitcase. As long as we've got races, and not just racing to be racing, but as long as we can race and have a chance at winning races, you know, I'm happy.
This is the 19th full season the Rudd has competed in NASCAR Winston Cup. Check out the consistency. 25% of the time, he finishes in the top five. Half of the races, he's in the top 10, and his average points finish is 7.72. By the way, he currently stands 8th in the points. When we come back, we check out the importance of transmission. Cup circuit shifting is a major part of getting around the Pocono International Raceway. So we went over to Hendrick Motorsports to talk to gear and transmission specialist Dan Ford. He explains transmissions in this week's Garage Pass.
It's a big racetrack, 2.5 mile racetrack, virtually flat, with a tremendously long front straightaway. So you have to put enough gear in the rear of the car to be able to run off turn one, accelerate off turn one, on that chute down to the tunnel turn, through the tunnel turn, accelerate again over to turn three, which is a flat, sweeping, long sweeping corner, and then you come on to the very long front straightaway, the longest front straightaway of any track we run. By the time you get right past the flag stand, the engine has peaked. It's peaked somewhere between 87 and 9,000. So you're still looking at a long distance to go before you get to turn one. So you have to have an overdrive you can shift into that will let you let the engine drop approximately 300 RPM, and then so it will pull on down to turn one without damage and without losing time on the racetrack.
The transmission of choice at Pocono is the one made by Jericho. It allows the drivers to shift without using the clutch, and it's very flexible as far as the number of gear ratios that can be used. For Pocono, they set up third gear as an overdrive, approximately a 0.90 to 1.
The clutch rides right here. The clutch rides on these splines. This fits in the pilot bearing in the back of the crankshaft. The power comes in here. If you're in high gear, the power comes right straight through, right out the output shaft. It's one-to-one. Wherever the engine turns, then the drive shaft turns the same amount. All right, if you're using low gear, second gear, or third gear, you work through the cluster gear, which the power comes in here, drops down to the cluster. If you're using low gear, it drops all the way down to here, back up, gives you reduction for low gear. When this particular transmission would be 2.64 to 1, and then out the tail shaft, which would be the gear that you would start in, leaving the pits.
The driver shifts the transmission by moving the gear shift lever, which moves the linkages on the outside of the transmission. The linkages cause the sliders inside to move and engage or disengage the different gears. Normally, teams use a transmission for 2,000 to 2,500 miles. But because of all the shifting that goes on at Pocono, they put brand new transmissions in the cars.
From Pocono, where you work the transmission so hard, downshifting, upshifting, and such a long race, you would just put a lot less miles on your gear set. I mean, I wouldn't even approach 2,000 miles on a Pocono transmission.
When we come back, we look into Tom Higgins' rearview mirror at some Pocono wildlife. Up race knows of the wildlife down in the infield. But as Tom Higgins looks back into his rearview mirror this week, he talks about a different kind of wildlife.
Through the years, fellas like this have disrupted several races at Pocono by getting onto the track. The late Neil Bonnet once hit and killed a deer during practice at Pocono. The Mountaintop Speedway is located in a vast forest in Pennsylvania that abounds with wildlife. So it isn't surprising that NASCAR officials and team members have experienced an unusual number of close encounters with critters. A few years ago, a rabbit hopped onto the track near the flag stand, forcing NASCAR to wave the caution.
Under caution here at Pocono for two reasons. They're repairing the wall, and we also have a jackrabbit on the racetrack right under the eagle. That's quite a shot there, isn't it?
It looks like the eagle's ready to land on top of the rabbit and take him away, and NASCAR is hoping it would.
Several inspectors and even pace car driver M.O. Langley chased that rabbit, much to the delight of fans.
Now let's see how they catch it. They're going to hem him in here. Here he comes. He's going to reach down. The rabbit simply wore out.
My favorite critter story from Pocono concerns one of these fellas right here and colorful old crew chief Jake Elder. One night, Jake played cards with some friends at their motel. After the game broke up, Jake took a trail through the woods to his nearby motel. Suddenly, a bear rose up, growled, and headed for Jake, who began running. Jake swears he barely got away. Jake Elder got the nickname Suitcase because he moved from team to team so many times. That night in Pocono is the fastest that Jake Elder ever moved.
We're fast moving toward the close. Check out Thursday's Splitfire Fastback, and we'll be back to wrap it up in a moment. Here are the broken left leg he suffered in a crash Tuesday night at Texas. He's expected to return to racing at the IRL event at Charlotte in late July. This weekend, Johnny Unser will drive his car and possibly fill in at the Colorado race. Damon Hill testified at the